Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of Important Locations for Map-Based Questions. This initiative has been brought to you by ActiPlus Academy for Civil Services, and my name is Shaik Datta. I'm the Faculty for Geography and Environment at ActiPlus Academy for Civil Services. In this initiative, we are looking at all the important locations which have appeared in the last year, current affairs. As you might be aware that UPSC has this tendency of asking questions which are map-based in nature. And these questions are usually asked from both India map as well as world map. So we have already seen various locations across the world, and not just across the world, but also in India. We have been focusing from one continent to another. Let's say, like, we have looked at South America, we have looked at Central Asia, we have looked at Europe, we have also looked at Southeast Asia, South Asia, etc. Right now, we'll be focusing on another part of the world. And we are going to look at the continent of Australia. And alongside Australia, we will also look at the surrounding areas, for example, New Zealand, as well as the Pacific Islands. So let us start with today's session, and let us look at the important locations which had appeared in the news from Australia. But before we do so, I want to give you some static information so far as Australia is concerned, so that you can understand the continent in a better manner. Okay, so let us have a look. So this is Australia, as you can understand. This entire continent, it is Australia. And Australia, it is divided into a number of parts. As you can understand, okay, this part is Western Australia. Here we have the Northern Territory. Here we have South Australia. Then we have Queensland over here. And then we have New South Wales. Finally, we have Victoria. So this is mainland Australia, and mainland Australia consists of Western Australia, Northern Territory, South Australia, Queensland, New South Wales, and Victoria. These are the important parts of Australia. So please remember the divisions: Western Australia, Northern Territory, South Australia, Queensland, New South Wales, and finally we have Victoria. Now, if we go further, then you will also get to see that there are many surrounding islands. One such very big surrounding island that we have is what is called as Tasmania. There are many this Australia as well as the surrounding islands, they are very important from the point of view of biodiversity as well. How it is important, we'll see, and why it was also in the news, that also we will see. So first, let us have a look at the important parts of Australia. So Australia, it is the smallest continent in the world. If you look at the various continents that we have, out of the various continents, Australia is the smallest one. But despite of being the smallest continent in the world, it is the largest island of the world. Okay, so remember, Australia is the smallest continent in the world, but at the same time, it is also the largest island of the world. That is why Australia is also called as the island continent. This is the other way in which Australia is mentioned. So Australia is referred to as the island continent. Next. Australia, it comprises of these parts. Which are the parts? Australia, we will see, it comprises of mainland Australia, Tasmania. Right now we saw the island, the big island which is right near Australia. It is called as Tasmania. And not just Tasmania, but also we have many other islands. For example, New Guinea, New Britain, and small neighboring islands are there. Okay? It comprises of mainland Australia, Tasmania, New Guinea, New Britain, and small neighboring islands. For example, we have Misool Island, Waigeo Island, and all of these are lying just to the northeast of the Maluku Islands at the edge of its continental shelf. I believe all of you would be aware about continental shelf. Continental shelf is the shallowest portion of the ocean. Basically, that part of the land which extends into the ocean, and over like the water which is present on top of the continental shelf area, that will be very, very shallow. And most of these waters, it will also be lit up by sunlight, hence it is called as the floating zone. So this continental shelf area, it is very, very important, both from economic point of view as well as from biodiversity point of view as well. Economic point of view, because in the continental shelf area, as you might be aware, this is just a little bit of introduction regarding the continental shelf. So in the continental shelf area, as you might be aware, it is very rich in various types of minerals, various types of fuels, you know, fossil fuels and all. And apart from that, if you look at it from the ecological point of view also, because it is lit up by sunlight. So that what happens is, okay, because it is lit up by sunlight, there's more amount of photosynthesis can be carried out by green plants which are living over here. And these green plants are nothing but phytoplanktons. Okay. These green plants, because of the presence or because it's lit up by sunlight, so what happens is this, okay, there is more number of phytoplanktons, and because there are more number of phytoplanktons, so automatically the number of zooplanktons which feed upon these phytoplanktons, so number of zooplanktons are also more in the continental shelf area. And the zooplanktons, they are fed upon by fish. So automatically we will get to see that this continental shelf area, it is very rich in fish reserves. So anyway, we get to see that Australia as a whole, it consists of mainland Australia, it consists of Tasmania, you have New Guinea, you have New Britain, and there are small neighboring islands such as Misool Island, Waigeo Island, which lie just to the northeast of the Maluku Islands at the edge of its continental shelf. Now, going further, Australia, if you see, it was discovered in 1770 by James Cook, who was an English sailor. Just a little bit of historical aspect of Australia. So Australia was discovered in 1770 by James Cook. And who was James Cook? He was an English sailor. If you look at the map of Australia, you'll find it lies completely in the southern hemisphere. It is completely lying in the southern hemisphere. No part of it lies in the northern hemisphere. Completely it will lie in the southern hemisphere. Australia is the only continent which is also a country. This is not seen in any other case, that a country itself is so big that it itself becomes a continent. So that is why it is also called as the island continent. And Australia, it is the only continent in the world which is also a country. It lies between the Indian Ocean and the Pacific Ocean. So if you look at Australia, let's see if we have the map of Australia. Yeah, so on one side, if you look at Australia, you will find on the western side of Australia, we have the Indian Ocean. Okay. On the western side of Australia, we'll have the Indian Ocean. And to the eastern side, you will have the Pacific Ocean. So Australia is a country which is bordered on one side by the Indian Ocean. And on the other side, it is bordered by the Pacific Ocean. You'll also see that it is surrounded by the Timor Sea. The Timor Sea, which is lying in the northwestern part, the Arafura Sea and the Gulf of Carpentaria in the north, the Great Barrier Reef in the northeast, and the Great Australian Bight, this Bight, B-I-G-H-T, Bight, in the south. What is that? This is also a marginal sea. I'll repeat once again, and it's very, very, very important that you remember, okay, which are the water bodies which surround Australia. So Australia, it is surrounded by Timor Sea in the northwest. Okay, so we have Timor Sea, where in the northwestern side we have Arafura Sea. Arafura Sea is lying in the, and Arafura Sea and Gulf of Carpentaria, it lies to the north. The Great Barrier Reef, it lies to the northeast. And then you have the Great Australian Bight, which lies to the south. So let us have a look at Australia, and you'll be able to find all these places. For example, look at the Timor Sea. The Timor Sea is lying to the northwestern side, as was mentioned over there. So Timor Sea lies to the northwest. You have the Arafura Sea, and you have the Gulf of Carpentaria. The Arafura Sea and the Gulf of Carpentaria, which lies to the north. So Timor Sea lies to the northwest. Arafura Sea and the Gulf of Carpentaria lies to the north. You have the Great Barrier Reef, which is again very, very famous, about which we'll discuss going ahead also. So the Great Barrier Reef, it lies to the northeast. It lies to the northeast. And then you have this marginal sea, that is the Great Australian Bight, B-I-G-H-T, not bright. Okay? Great Australian Bight, which is like a marginal sea, and it lies to the south. Apart from that, you will also have other areas. For example, the Tasman Sea is there, which lies near Tasmania, that is the island of Tasmania. Apart from that, you will also find the Bass Strait, which is there. What is a strait? As you might be aware, strait is a narrow stretch of water body which connects two larger water bodies. So the narrow stretch of water body which connects two larger water bodies, that is called as strait. And you, as you can understand, over here we have a large water body, that is the Tasmanian Sea or the Tasman Sea. And here you have the Southern Ocean. So these two are getting connected by this vast strait. Okay. So remember the important locations around Australia. So once again, let us quickly recall Timor Sea to the northwest, Arafura Sea and the Gulf of Carpentaria to the north. To the northeast, we have the Great Barrier Reef, and to the south, we have the Great Australian Bight. And then we have the Tasman Sea lying to the southeastern side, and Tasman Sea is connected to the Southern Ocean through the Bass Strait, which lies between Australia and Tasmania. So these are the important water bodies around Australia. Next up. Okay, next we get to see to the southeastern part of the mainland, that is to the southeastern part of the mainland Australia continent, lies the mountainous island of Tasmania. Already we have seen the location of Tasmania, but to the southeastern side, as you can see over here also, this Tasmania, it is lying to the southeastern side of the mainland Australia, and it is mainly mountainous island. It is mainly mountainous in nature. Next, in terms of settlement, Australia is called as the New Island. Okay. So the world is divided into different parts. For example, we have some countries which are called as the Old World country, and then we also have some parts of the world which are called as the New World countries. So what is the difference between this Old World and New World? The difference mainly lies in the history of civilization of these parts. So basically, whichever parts of the world have been historically settled for a long, long period of time, that is, there is a very long history of civilization. So those parts are called as the Old World countries. So for, say for example, if you look at Indus Valley, if you look at Mesopotamia or the Nile Valley civilizations or Europe as a whole, these areas, they are the Old World countries. On the other hand, if you look at places which have been comparatively recently settled, okay, comparatively recently these areas have been settled in, then they are called as New Land or New World countries. For example, you find USA, that is North America. Similarly, if you look at Australia, Australia is a country which has comparatively a very recent history of civilization. The civilization over here is not as old as, let's say, the Indus Valley civilization, the Mesopotamian civilization, Nile Valley civilization, etc. But the thing is, it does not mean that people did not used to exist in Australia earlier. Definitely, there used to be people who used to live over here earlier, but most of them were indigenous native people who were native to this particular area. The Europeans, they came much later. The Europeans, they came and settled in this area much, much later. Let us just try to see. While indigenous Australians, there are many nomadic tribes in Australia, right? And now their population has gone down, but historically, if we see that the people who are native to Australia, there are many such tribes who have been the indigenous people of Australia. So while indigenous Australians, they have inhabited the continent for tens of thousands of years, and they have traded with the nearby islanders, the first documented landing on Australia by an European was only in 1606. So yes, there have been many natives, or the population of natives was quite large, and we had indigenous Australians as well. And these Australians, they were carrying out, these indigenous Australians, they were carrying out trade with the nearby islands. On the other hand, if we look at the history of European settlement in Australia, so that has been comparatively, that has happened much more recently, comparatively PC, because we get to see the first documented landing in Australia by an European, it only took place around 1606. Now, who landed over here? And it's very interesting that we get to see it was the Dutch explorers. The Dutch means the people who belong to Holland, Netherlands. So it was the Dutch explorers who came to this continent first. And that is why we get to see the Dutch explorer whose name is William Janszoon. Remember this, William Janszoon, and don't get confused. See over here. It was discovered in 1770 by James Cook, who was an English sailor. But the first person who landed over here, his name, or the first person to land, first European to land in Australia, his name was William Jansoon, and he landed on the western side of Cape York Peninsula, and he charted at about 300 kilometers of the coastline. So he was exploring Australia. He landed in Australia for the very first time. And his name is William Jansoon, who was a Dutch explorer. And since it was discovered by Dutch people, like the Dutch explorer William Jansoon, so since he discovered it, so he named it as New Holland. Okay, you understand why Australia was initially given the name of New Holland. It was given the name of New Holland because it was discovered by the Dutch people, that is the Dutch explorer William Jansoon, and he thought, okay, this is another new part of Netherlands, and it will be a part of Netherlands, so he called it as New Holland. Next, we get to see that it was the British explorer, that is Matthew Flinders. So it was Matthew Flinders who was a British explorer. He was the first to circumnavigate Australia, and he gave the name Australia. So what is meant by circumnavigation? Circumnavigation means going around the entire continent. So basically, James Flinders, he went around this entire continent. He sailed around the entire continent. That is what is called as circumnavigation. So he sailed around the entire continent, and he gave the name as Australia. Earlier, Australia was called as New Holland. So this is regarding the historical aspect of Australia. Now let us go into the physical divisions of Australia. Let us go into the physical features of Australia. We'll be talking about its climate. We'll be talking about the physiographical divisions of Australia. Okay. So if you look at the northern part, now it's very interesting over here. You see, I hope all of you can actually see the Tropic of Capricorn. This is the Tropic of Capricorn, and it is passing right through Australia. Now, as you might be aware, that since this Tropic of Capricorn is passing right through Australia, so the part which lies between the Tropic of Capricorn and the equator, the part of Australia which lies, that is the northern part of Australia which lies between the Tropic of Capricorn and the equator, that part we can say lies in the tropics, right? Because what is the tropical zone? The tropical zone is basically the part which lies between the Tropic of Cancer or the Tropic of Capricorn and the equator. In dono ke beech, that the part which lies between the Tropic of Cancer or the Tropic of Capricorn and the equator is what is called as the tropics. So here you get to see that the Tropic of Capricorn is passing like this, and the equator is present to the north. So basically, this entire northern part of Australia, it will have a tropical type of climate. See over here. The northern half of Australia, it is situated in the tropical zone. I hope all of you can understand. And since it is present in the tropical zone, so the northern part of Australia is actually having a moderate type of climate. That is not extreme type of climate. It has a moderate type of climate. So the northern half of Australia, it is situated in the tropical zone. Whereas if you look at the southern half, it is situated in the temperate zone. There has been a bit of a spelling mistake over here. It should be temperate zone. So what is temperate zone? Temperate zone is basically that part of Australia which lies beyond the tropics. Okay? It lies beyond the tropics, and it lies close to the part of Australia which is present between the tropics and the Antarctic Circle. That is what is called as the temperate zone. So southern part of Australia, it lies in the temperate zone. The northern part of Australia lies in the tropical zone. And that is why you can understand that this southern part, it will experience much more extremes of temperature. So this entire southern part, it lies in the temperate zone. And temperate zone ka matlab wahi hota hai, that there will be extremes of temperature. During summer, it will be extremely warm, it will be extremely hot. And during winter, it will be extremely cold. Jabki northern part jo hai, the northern part, it is much more moderate. The range of temperature which is there, the annual range of temperature is quite narrow. It is not very large. Okay, so this is with regards to the climate of Australia, and the Tropic of Capricorn, it passes through the middle of the continent. It passes right through the middle of the continent, as you can see over here. So, again, another little bit of question which can be asked, because Australia has been there in the news. So if you are asked which are those parts which are crisscrossed by the Tropic of Capricorn, as you can see, it is Western Australia, Northern Territory and Queensland. So Western Australia, Northern Territory and Queensland, these are the parts which are through which we will find the Tropic of Capricorn will pass. So Western Australia, Northern Territory and Queensland, these are those parts of Australia through which the Tropic of Capricorn will pass, whereas South Australia, New South Wales, as well as Victoria, all of these will lie below the Tropic of Capricorn. When I say below, it basically means it lies in the temperate zone. Now moving forward, two-third part of Australia, it is covered with plateau, and hence it is called as Western Plateau, where rainfall is very scanty and deserts have developed. So we'll get to see, it's a very interesting thing. I mean, if you look at the structure of Australia, you will find that it is all the important cities, you know, all the important cities are situated along the coastline. That is, most of the important cities or the biggest cities of Australia are coastal cities. They are port cities. Why is that the case? Why has most of the cities of Australia developed along the coastline? That is because the interior part of Australia, it is actually desertic in nature. And it is like highland area. Say for example, two-third part of Australia is covered with a plateau. It is covered by a plateau, and that is what is called as the Western Plateau area. Okay, two-thirds part of Australia is covered by a plateau, and that is what is called as the Western Plateau area. And in this plateau area, we get to see rainfall will be very, very scanty, and not just rainfall is scanty, but also we get to see deserts have developed. Now, there can be so many different reasons as to why deserts can develop in an area. Okay. So many different reasons can be there. And one of the major reasons why deserts have developed mainly in the interior part of Australia is because of the continentality effect. What is meant by continentality effect? Because these areas are lying very far away from the coast. And since they are lying very, very far away from the coast, so what will happen? Okay, there will be not too much of rainfall. They are very, very dry area. And since there is not too much rainfall, so humidity is also less. If humidity is less, then there is less amount of evaporation. Since evaporation is less, so there is no cloud formation. And if there is no cloud formation, automatically rainfall will be less. So it's like a cycle. Now, if you have cloudless sky, then automatically you can understand that the intensity of radiation in these interior parts of Australia, the intensity of radiation will be very high. When I say intensity of radiation, I mean to say that the incoming solar radiation, that is insolation, cannot be blocked by the cloud cover, because there is no cloud cover. And because there is no cloud cover, so all these insolation or the incoming solar radiation will be able to reach the surface of the earth, and that will lead to very high temperature developing. Okay? So two-third part of Australia is covered with plateau, which is known as Western Plateau. And in this area, we get to see rainfall is very scanty and deserts have developed. Right. Apart from that, there are other factors as well. But anyway, most important factor is the continentality of it. Next, let us also look at some more parts of Australia. The eastern part of Australia, it is covered with a chain of highlands from the Cape York to the island of Tasmania. And it is known as the Great Dividing Range. So I hope it is here. So if it is not here, you can have a look at the physical map of Australia. So the thing is, Great Dividing Range is the, yeah, it is there. And I'm not sure if it is visible clearly out here. So over here, this is where you have this entire area. You actually have a range, a mountain range. And this mountain range is what is called as the Great Dividing Range. Very, very important location, physical location for Australia. It is called as the Great Dividing Range. It extends like this only. It extends like this. This is what is called as the Great Dividing Range. So the eastern part of Australia is covered by a chain of highlands from Cape York to the island of Tasmania. And that is what is called as the Great Dividing Range. Next, there is also a coral reef along the eastern coast of Australia, and this is called as the Great Barrier Reef. All of you would have heard about the Great Barrier Reef. So this is where the Great Barrier Reef lies. Here you have the Great Barrier Reef. Very, very important, because it is the largest coral reef that is there. This is called as the Great Barrier Reef, and it lies along the northeastern side of Australia. Extremely important for biodiversity. And not just is it important for biodiversity, but we also get to see, so let us know a little bit more regarding this Great Barrier Reef. It is lying along the northeastern side of Australia, and it is more than 1,900 kilometers long. So you can understand it's very, very, very long coral reef. Plus, the northern part of the eastern side of this coral reef is very dangerous for the vessels. Vessels matlab ships and all, ships and boats. This northern part of the eastern side of this coral reef, that is very dangerous for the vessels. Achha, just I would like to tell you regarding corals as well. All of you would be aware regarding corals. Quickly, I'll just try to revise the part of coral reef. So coral reef, as you might all be aware, it is a type of symbiotic relationship, or what we also refer to as mutualism. So it's a type of symbiotic relationship or mutualism between two entities. Which are those two entities? One is called as the coral polyps, and the other is called as zooxanthellae. Coral polyps are nothing but microscopic animals, whereas the zooxanthellae, they are nothing but microscopic plants. What happens? It's like an algae, you can say. What happens is there is a symbiotic relationship which develops between the zooxanthellae and the coral polyps. What is symbiotic relationship? What is mutualism? That is a mutually beneficial relationship. So what happens over here is this, that is the coral polyps, they build a structure which is called as a reef. What is a reef? A reef is a structure. It is usually made out of calcium. And why is it made out of calcium? Because the coral polyps, their skeletons is made up of calcium, and when they die, the skeletons, they get fused to the already existing structure, and that is how the structure keeps on growing. So ultimately the coral reef is a structure which is made out of calcium, and we get to see that on this structure, which is usually present in the shallower parts of the ocean, so on this structure you will have such kind of algae taking shelter. So how is it a mutually beneficial relationship? What happens is, as you know, an algae is like a green plant. So an algae will produce food by the process of photosynthesis. Now the food that the algae produces, that is used by the coral polyps for their nutrition. Almost 95% of the nutrition of the coral polyps is derived from the food which is produced by the zooxanthellae. On the other hand, you might also ask how the so this is how the coral polyps are getting benefited from the zooxanthellae, that is the algae. But the question is, how is the algae getting benefited? How is it a mutualism type of relationship? Algae is getting benefited because it is getting shelter. So basically the zooxanthellae, the coral polyps or the coral reef, it is providing the algae with the shelter. And not only that, but also we get to see that the algae is getting a higher platform, an upraised platform, an elevated platform is being provided to the algae by the coral reef. Because the algae, it is getting an upraised platform and an elevated platform. So what happens is it is getting much more access to sunlight. And that is why it can carry out photosynthesis in a much more effective manner. Had the coral reef not been there, then these zooxanthellae would not get that upraised platform. And automatically the effectiveness or the amount of photosynthesis that it could have done otherwise, that would have been much less. So anyway, this is how you have the symbiotic relationship developing. But at the same time, you would also be aware, okay, because the coral reefs are made out of calcium, so they ideally should be white in color. But if you have observed a coral reef, then you find it is made up of vivid colors, very deep colors, very beautiful colors are there. That is why coral reefs are also called as the rainforest of the ocean or rainforest of the sea. Now, what happens is this, okay, coral reefs, they will have all these deep colors because of the presence of the zooxanthellae. So it is the zooxanthellae which provides the coral reef with colors. Otherwise, it would be completely white. And it is because of the presence of the zooxanthellae that we also get to see a large number of fish and other aquatic organisms will also take up residence within the coral reef. So the coral reef area is very, very, very biodiverse, and that is why it is also called as the rainforest of the ocean. But then there are certain phenomena where we get to see that the zooxanthellae might decide to desert the coral reef. Desert means it might decide to leave the coral reef and go somewhere else. Why will such a phenomena take place? Like, there is a very good mutualism relationship between the zooxanthellae and the coral polyps. But when there are certain changes in the environment, like let's say fluctuation of the temperature, or let's say change in the pH level of the water, or even change in the salinity level, there will be, or even if there is pollution taking place, so there will be a phenomena where we'll get to see that the zooxanthellae will desert or will decide to leave the coral reefs and go away. This kind of a phenomena is what is referred to as coral bleaching. This is what is called as coral bleaching. So as you might be aware, when you use bleach is used to make to whiten your clothes, mainly. White clothes ko whiten karne ke liye we use bleach. So coral bleaching is also a phenomena where we get to see that due to fluctuations in the environment or due to changes in the characteristic of the water, property of the water, or due to pollution, you might find that the zooxanthellae is leaving the coral reef. And automatically, as you can understand, if the zooxanthellae is not present, the very beautifully colored coral reefs will turn white. And if they turn white, then what will happen? That entire mutualism relationship will break down and the corals will not have the zooxanthellae to produce their food. As I told you, almost 95% of the nutrition of the coral polyps is derived from the zooxanthellae. So if the zooxanthellae goes away from the coral reef, what will the corals feed upon? So that is why eventually we'll get to see that the corals will slowly start to die if not, you know, prompt action is taken to undo whatever change has taken place. So if there has been some kind of a change in the environment which has led to coral bleaching, so in such a case, ideally all such changes should be rectified so that the zooxanthellae comes back to the coral reef, and hence the coral polyps, they do not die. Okay, so please understand, the coral polyps, they usually are not dead. If they become dead, then they turn white. So why I say this is because the Great Barrier Reef has been subjected to numerous occasions, or there has been numerous occasions where complete coral bleaching has taken place in the Great Barrier Reef. And why coral bleaching has taken place? Coral bleaching has taken place because of various factors, but one of the major factors which was found to be the reason behind the coral bleaching taking place in the Great Barrier Reef again and again was because of the sunscreen which was being used by the people who would go to the beach. So the beach goers, they would be using sunscreen on their bodies, and when they would take a bath in the, or they would swim in the ocean, ultimately the water, it will take away all those sunscreen, and ultimately those sunscreen will get deposited on the coral reefs, and that led to bleaching taking place again and again along this Great Barrier Reef. Very, very important area, the Great Barrier Reef. And we also get to see that in this Great Barrier Reef, scientists are trying to come up with various methods to create artificial coral reefs. So artificially coral reefs are being created. And why artificially coral reefs are being created? The reason is this, because of the emission of huge amount of greenhouse gases into the environment. Greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide, etc. What is happening is this, this carbon dioxide, it will be absorbed by the water. That is, the ocean water acts like a sink for, it acts like a carbon sink. It will absorb the carbon dioxide. And when it absorbs the carbon dioxide, eventually it will lead to the formation of dilute acid like carbonic acid. This carbonic acid will react with the calcium se bana hua coral reef. And that is how the coral reefs are getting destroyed. They are getting damaged. So to rectify this again, what the scientists over here, they are trying to do is that they are trying to create artificial reefs. By creating artificial reefs, which are not made out of calcium as such, they will be able to ensure that the coral reef, the extent that does not reduce. Because if the coral reef gets damaged, if there is a coral bleaching taking place, then not only the coral polyps will get or will be affected, but alongside that we will also get to see numerous species, huge number of species of aquatic organisms and plants will also be affected. That is an undesirable scenario. It is an undesirable situation. Okay. Next, this is the Great Dividing Range. I was talking about the Great Dividing Range along the eastern side of Australia. This is the Great Dividing Range, and this is the Great Barrier Reef. As you might also be aware that coral reefs, there are many theories with regards to the formation of coral reef. One such theory was given by Darwin, which is called as a subsidence theory of coral reef. And there we get to see, as per the subsidence theory, coral reefs can be formed in three stages. There are three stages of the formation of coral reef. For example, initially we will have a fringing reef getting formed. And what is meant by the subsidence theory? Subsidence theory basically says that around an island, a coral reef will initially be formed, and as the island keeps on subsiding over a period of time, due to various phenomena like tectonic plate movement, etc., as an island keeps on subsiding over a period of time, you will get to see that the coral reef will develop more and more. And there will be further modification and development of the coral reef around the island. So initially, the coral reef is what is called as a fringing reef, which is the first type of coral reef which develops around an island. As time goes on, the fringing reef changes into a barrier reef. As time goes on, the fringing reef, it will change into a barrier reef. And very interesting thing is, between barrier reef and the mainland, you will have some amount of gap, which is usually occupied by, like over here, you will get to see that there will be some amount of seawater being present. There will be a gap between the barrier reef and the mainland, and that will be occupied by seawater. Okay, it will form a lagoon. Acha. So you will have a fringing reef, then you will have a barrier reef, and eventually the third stage of coral reef formation, that is what is called as an atoll, A-T-O-L-L, atoll. Atoll is a group of islands, and atoll is basically a group of coral islands which surround a lagoon. So there are three stages of the formation of a coral reef. Number one, fringing reef. Number two, barrier reef. And number three, atoll. Please go through this part of your physical geography, oceanography, if you are not aware of it. It's very important. Have a look at it. Next part, we get to see Mount Kosciuszko. Whatever is the pronunciation, that is not important. But remember this name, Mount Kosciuszko is the highest peak in Australia. It is the highest peak in Australia. Next. Near Australia, you'll also have New Zealand, and the highest peak of New Zealand is Mount Cook. Okay. The highest peak of New Zealand is Mount Cook. Now, when it comes to Australia, there are some very, very important rivers, out of which the most important river is the Murray Darling River. So there are two rivers, as you can see over here. One is called as Murray. One part is called as Murray, M-U-R-R-Y, Murray. And then you also have the Darling. So these two rivers, they are the most important rivers so far as Australia is concerned, the Murray and the Darling. And these Murray and Darling, their basin is also very, very important. So this entire area is called as the Murray-Darling Basin. Okay? This is the river basin. So apart from Murray-Darling, we also get to see there are some other important rivers as well. So you have Murray River and you have Darling River. And apart from that, you have this Murrumbeek River, plus you have Lachlan River, Warrego River, Cooper Creek and Paroo River. Now again, it is not important for you to remember all the names or where they are located. But what is more important is just remember Murray and Darling. These are two very important rivers which are located towards the southeastern side. The southeastern side, that is near Victoria and New South Wales, near the New South Wales province and the Victoria province, you will get to see these two places. One is Murray, the other is Darling. Next up. River Murray, it is the longest river in Australia. It's very important to remember. It is River Murray, which is the longest river of Australia. And if you look at New Zealand, then it is Waikato River. That is not so important. Just remember New Zealand, because New Zealand was also there in the news. Okay. So River Murray, it is the longest river in Australia. The Waikato River, it is the longest river in case of New Zealand. Next. What are the important waterfalls that we have in Australia? So there are many such names. Just have a look at the names, not necessary that you'll be able to remember all of them, but just go through them once. For example, we have Montezuma Falls, Tia Falls are there, Russell Falls are there, Mackenzie Falls, Blanco Falls, Fitzroy Falls, then we have Allenboro Falls, Michelle Falls, we have Wallaman Falls, and we have Jim Jim Falls. Okay? So just go through it once or twice. So we have Montezuma Falls, we have Tia Falls, Russell Falls, Mackenzie Falls, Blanco Falls, Fitzroy Falls, Ellenboro Falls, Michelle Falls, and Wallaman Falls. Plus, we also have Jim Falls. These are the important waterfalls which are there. Apart from that, there are also 41 major lakes in Australia and over 4,000 smaller lakes in the entire continent. So 41 major lakes and over 4,000 smaller lakes in the continent of Australia. Next. We will have this Lake Tuapo. Lake Tuapo, it is a crater lake and one of the beautiful lakes in New Zealand. Which was formed by the violent volcanic eruption. So Lake Tuapo is where Lake Tuapo is present in New Zealand. Lake Tuapo, it is a crater lake and it is one of the beautiful lakes in New Zealand. In case of Australia, there are 41 major lakes. Here, in case of Australia, we have an important lake. It is called as Lake Eyre. So Lake Eyre, it is also officially named as Katithanda Lake Eyre. It is a large saltwater lake in Australia. Very, very important Lake Eyre. It is a saltwater lake. It is a very large saltwater lake in Australia. In Australia, as you might be aware, there are many different type of, very strange type of species are there. Now the question is, why do we have such strange type of species? For example, you will have kangaroos, and kangaroos are found nowhere else. For example, you will have wallabies, you will have wombats, you will have the duck-billed platypus, dingoes. All of these are very, very, koala bear, and these are only found in Australia. They are endemic to Australia. Question is, why do we have such strange species in Australia which are not found anywhere else? The reason lies behind the isolated position of Australia. If you look at Australia, it is surrounded by water on all its sides. So that is why it is very, very isolated. And that is why the evolutionary pathway. It took a completely different path in case of Australia as compared to the other mainland countries. So let's say when it comes to India, India is connected to the mainland of Asia. That is why the number of such unique creatures that will be less if we have a mainland, because you will find such kind of creatures will be present in other places as well. Whereas because of the isolated nature of the continent of Australia, you will get to see that you have a very different type of pathway for evolution which has been taken up by the species over here, and that is why you have many new species coming up over here. Different type of speciation has taken place over here. New types of species have evolved which are found nowhere else. That is because of the isolated nature of the continent of Australia, because it's an island country. Okay, and also not just that island continent, but also you should remember that you have the Tropic of Capricorn passing through the middle of Australia. So the temperature is high, plus you have the entire continent surrounded by sea. So that is why along the coastal area, the rainfall will also be high. So that is why you have high temperature, you have good rainfall, and as a result of which, what happens, there is the evolution of new species which have come up. Australia is known for its deserts. As I told you, there are many important deserts. Most of these deserts are situated along the interior portions of the country. What are those deserts? Very important. Have a look. We have the Great Victoria Desert, the Great Sandy Desert, the Tanami Desert, Simpson's Desert, Gibson Desert, Little Sandy Desert, Strelzelica Desert, Stuart Stony Desert, Tirari Desert, and we have the Peditka Desert. So these are the important ones: the Great Victoria Desert, the Great Sandy Desert, the Tanami Desert, Simpson's Desert, Gibson Desert, Little Sandy Desert, the Strelzelica Desert, and we have the Stuart Stony Desert, the Tirari Desert, and the Peditka Desert. So again, some of the important deserts I have shown in this particular diagram, and you can see it from here itself. So we have the Great Sandy Desert over here, and it is surrounded by the Little Sandy Desert. So you have the Great Sandy Desert, and you also have the Little Sandy Desert. You also have the Gibson Desert over here. So Great Sandy Desert, Little Sandy Desert, Gibson Desert. We also have the Tanami Desert out here. So Tanami Desert is over here. Then going to the lower part, this is the Great Victoria Desert. The Great Victoria Desert. And we have the Simpson's Desert out here. Simpson's Desert. So Great Sandy Desert, Gibson Desert, Little Sandy Desert, Great Victoria Desert, the Tanami Desert, the Simpson Desert. And we also have the Stuart Stony Desert over here. Stuart Stony Desert. The Strelzelica Desert is over here. Srezarika Desert. And you also have the Tirari Desert, Tirari Desert. Very important, have a look at the locations of the deserts in Australia. It is actually these parts of Australia which are very, very dry, which are very, very arid, which are situated far away from the coast and which suffer from this continuity effect. So these are the areas which were very badly affected because of the recent bushfire. We'll talk about the bushfire in a while, but before that, we are learning about the Australian continent. Okay. Next. What are the important food crops? Whereas in case of Australia, the major food crops of Australia are wheat, barley, canola, sorghum, oats, rice, pulses, and corn or maize. Okay. The major food crops are wheat, barley, canola, sorghum, oats, rice, pulses, and corn. That is maize. These are the important food crops which are found in Australia. If you look at the major cash crops of Australia, then it is coffee, cocoa, tea, sugarcane, cotton, and spices. Okay, coffee, cocoa, tea, sugarcane, cotton, and spices. These are the important cash crops of Australia. If you look at the major straits, the important straits, again, what is a strait? A strait is a narrow stretch of water body which connects two larger water bodies. So if you look at the important straits, you will have the Barker Passage. Again, whenever we are looking at these videos, whenever you are going through such videos of map pointing, I would suggest that you sit down with your atlas. In your atlas, open the physical and the political map of Australia and then you try to relate it. So, for example, if you look at the major straits around Australia, you'll have the Barker Passage, you'll have the Bass Strait, the Clarence Strait, which is present in the Northern Territory, you have the Dunda Strait, Endeavour Strait, Investigator Strait, the Rip, South Passage, also called as the Footman, Abrolhos, the Suda Passage, or the Suda Bay Passage, and the Torres Strait. Barker Passage, you try to find out all these different straits and the different water bodies. Around Australia, you have the Barker Passage, you have the Bass Strait, Clarence Strait, also called in the North Territory. You have the Dunda Strait, the Endeavour Strait, the Investigator Strait, the Rip, South Passage, or also called as the Hoodman, Abrolhos, the Suda Bays Passage, as well as the Torres Strait. So these are the major straits around Australia. Next up, you will also have the climate, the northern section of Australia already we have seen, but let us quickly go through it. The northern section of Australia, which is having a tropical type of climate, because as you can understand, the northern part of Australia, it lies between the Tropic of Capricorn and the Equator. So the northern section of Australia, it has a more tropical influenced climate. It is hot and humid in the summer and it is quite warm and dry in the winter. It is not cold, it is warm and dry. Why is it warm? It is warm because it is lying within the tropics. So the northern section of Australia, it has a more tropical influenced climate. And we get to see that it is hot and humid during the summer. It is quite warm and dry during the winter. On the other hand, the southern parts of Australia, they are cooler with having mild summer and cool, sometimes very rainy winters as well. So southern parts, for example, you know, cities like Melbourne and all. So over here, we will get to see that the because it is lying in the temperate zone. And since it is lying in the temperate zone, so the range of temperature will be much wider. It will have a wide range of temperature. So the southern parts are cooler with mild summers and the winters will be cool and sometimes also rainy. If you look at the ethnic groups which are present and the languages which are spoken, so you'll get to see that 90% are Europeans, while 7% are Asian. 2% are Aboriginal and the rest are all related to the people of Papua New Guinea, Indonesia and others from Southeast Asia and Australasia. 80% of them speak English. So once again, if you look at the ethnic group, so you see the natives of Australia or who used to be the Aboriginals in Australia, their percentage has now got reduced to only 2%. Okay. The Aboriginals of Australia, their numbers have got reduced to only 2%. On the other hand, you have 90% of the population being made up of Europeans. 7% of the population is consisting of Asian people. And 2% is consisting of the Aboriginal, the natives. And rest of them, you get to see, they belong to, I mean, the rest of the people are from Papua New Guinea, which is an island. We'll look at it later on. Indonesia and also Southeast Asia and Australasia. Southeast Asia and Australasia. 80% of them are English speakers. Next up, if you look at the important cities of Australia, then you will find important cities, for example, Newcastle is there, Sydney is there, Melbourne, Adelaide, and Perth. These are the important cities of Australia, that is Newcastle, Sydney, Melbourne, Adelaide, and Perth. Newcastle, Sydney, Melbourne, Adelaide, and Perth. Let us see if we have a... if you look at the map of Australia, there you will find all these cities. Have a look over here. So let's see which map it is clearly visible. Over here, some of the important cities are visible. You see over here, Perth. Perth is an important city, again situated along the coast. You see over here, Adelaide. Adelaide is another important city which is situated along the coast. And similarly, you will also find we have Melbourne over here in the southern part. So Perth, Adelaide, Melbourne. Melbourne is also a port city. We'll also find Sydney present along the coast of Australia. And you will also find Brisbane. Another important city is Darwin. So you see over here all the important cities which are there, be it Perth, or if you look at Adelaide, or if you look at Victoria or Melbourne for that matter, if you look at Sydney, Brisbane or Darwin, all of them are coastal cities. What is the capital of Australia? The capital of Australia, many of you would be confused, because a lot of people, they tend to answer that it is Sydney which is the capital of Australia. The answer is no. If you see the capital of Australia, it is Canberra. Canberra is the capital of Australia. And if you look at Canberra, Canberra's location, that is also almost situated along the coast. So all the important cities of Australia are coastal cities or port cities. All of them are situated along the coastal area. Okay, so we have looked at the important cities of Australia. Now moving on to the important trees of Australia. Important trees are palm, we have bamboo, birch, deodar and eucalyptus. These are the important trees of Australia. So palm, bamboo, birch, deodar and eucalyptus. These are the important trees of Australia. Next, not only do we have deserts, not only we have coastal areas, but very interestingly in Australia, we also have grasslands being present. These grasslands are examples. So both types of grasslands, actually grasslands are of two types. So you will have tropical grasslands and you will also have temperate grasslands. Both tropical as well as temperate grasslands are found in Australia. So there are two types of grasslands which are found in Australia. For example, tropical grasslands are also found and temperate grasslands are also found. The tropical grasslands, as you might be aware, they are called as savanna. Now don't get confused, savanna is a type of grassland. And these savannas are not only found in Australia, they are also found in Africa as well. So savanna is a type of tropical grasslands. So, and these kind of savanna grasslands, they are found both in Australia as well as in Africa. On the other hand, you will also have temperate grasslands. And these temperate grasslands in Australia, they are referred to as downs. In the temperate, in Australia, the temperate grasslands, they are referred to as downs. Whereas the tropical grasslands are referred to as savanna. Now, because you have grasslands, so automatically you will understand that wherever there are grasslands, you will have a large population of livestock. Very large population of livestock will be there who will graze on these grasslands. Similarly, Australia is also known for its livestock population, especially for its sheep. There are some very special varieties of sheep or very special breeds of sheep which are found in Australia, or not only Australia but also in New Zealand in huge numbers. In fact, it is said that in New Zealand, the number of sheep is more than the number of people actually. So in Australia also, we get to see that there is a very huge population of sheep, and Australia is especially famous for this particular breed, which is called as the Merino sheep, M-E-R-I-N-O, Merino sheep. It is very famous. It is a breed of sheep. It's not only found in Australia, it is found in other places as well. But in Australia, the Merino sheep population is very, very large. And not only is the population large, but also the yield is very, very high. Yield of what? Yield of wool. Okay, so it will have a very high yield of wool. It will have a very high yield of wool. Next, what is the type of vegetation that we get to see in grassland areas? देखो इन द सवाना ग्रासलैंड्स वी हैव सॉल्ट ब्रश एंड मुल्गा बुशेस सो देयर आर सम वेरी स्कैंटी वेजिटेशन एज यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड बिकॉज इवन ग्रासलैंड एरियाज दीज एरियाज दे डू नॉट गेट सफिशियंट अमाउंट ऑफ रेनफॉल and because they do not get sufficient amount of rainfall so that is why you will never find trees growing over here because as you might be aware there is a concept which is called as ecological succession sometimes also called as biological succession which basically says that in an area you will find that one vegetation community will be succeeded by another vegetation community over a period of time with the change in the surrounding climatic conditions So in an area, if the climatic condition keeps on changing, then over a period of time, you will get to see that an inferior existing vegetation community will be replaced by a superior vegetation community. And this will keep on happening till a stable vegetation community is achieved, which will be in equilibrium with the surrounding environmental conditions. This gradual and successive nature or this gradual and successive process of change of vegetation community from one to the other in an area with the changes in the surrounding environment is what is called as ecological succession. So UPSC had once asked a question in prelims which said that in the grasslands why are the grasses not replaced by trees because due to ecological succession ideally the grasses should have been replaced by trees but in the grasslands we do not find that happening. Why is the case? The thing is in the grasslands trees will not replace the grasses because the rainfall is not sufficient to support the trees as you can understand trees will require much more amount of water as compared to the grasses and since that amount of water is unavailable in case of a grassland that is why trees will not be able to replace grasses in case of a grassland so since we do not have too much of rainfall automatically the vegetation community which is found in the grasslands It is mainly scanty vegetation, sparse vegetation will be there. What kind of species will be found? For example, you will find in the savanna grassland, that is the tropical grasslands, you will find salt brush, you will find mulga bushes. Mulga is the name of a species of bush. So mulga bushes, this kind of bushes will be found. Also, eucalyptus trees will be found growing here and there in the down area. Down matlab, the temperate grassland. So over there, you will find some amount of eucalyptus trees are also found over here. That is why downs are also called as parkland of Australia. Parks, like how you have parks, right? You will have meadows and then you will have a tree here and there. So that is why downs are also referred to as the parkland of Australia. But so Australia is the driest inhabited continent in the world. It is the driest inhabited means that people live over it. So it is the driest inhabited continent in the world. And its interior has one of the lowest rainfalls in the world. And about 3/4 of the land is arid or semi-arid in nature. Again, almost 3/4, that is 75% of the land is actually arid or semi-arid. And interior part of Australia has one of the lowest rainfall in the world. It is the driest inhabited continent in the world. Now, let's quickly look at the important cities which are there in Australia. So important cities, if we look at Australia, then we have Perth. Perth is situated on the Swan River. Perth is situated on the Swan River. Not necessary that you have to remember how far away it is from the sea, but remember if there is some important river on the banks of which a particular city lies, and that too if it is an important city, then you should try to remember the name of the river as well. So Perth, it lies on the Swan River, and it is an important area for it. It's an important manufacturing center for iron and steel, vehicles, machinery, textiles, etc. Iron and steel, vehicles, machinery, textile. So these all are found over here in Perth. Manufacturing industries for this. It's another important thing that we have is called as Fremantle area or Fremantle. In Fremantle, which is present on the mouth of the Swan River, it is the largest port of Western Australia. So if you look at Western Australia, over there we will have the Swan River, and at the mouth of the Swan River, you will have the city which is called as Fremantle. And Fremantle, it is the largest port of Western Australia. Next, two very important cities that you should be aware of. One is called as Kalgoorlie, the other is called as Coolgardie. Kalgoorlie and Coolgardie, very, very important. And you will also find the mention of these cities in your book, which is called as Gochileon. So if you are preparing for UPSC, definitely you would have gone through Gochileon, which is a very important book so far as geography preparation is concerned. And here also you will find the mention of Coolgardie and Kalgoorlie. Now, what are these? Coolgardie and Kalgoorlie. You see, wherever the climate will be arid, wherever you will have dry climate, wherever the climate will be arid and rainfall will be very less, that is desertic areas. In desertic areas, you will usually get to see that there will be deposits of copper. Okay, so these dry areas, these arid areas, these are very famous for copper deposits. Similarly, over here also in Australia, because there are so many different deserts in Australia, so we get to see some important copper mining towns have come up. Some important copper mining towns have got developed. Some of the largest copper mining towns are these, Coolgardie and Coolgardie. So these are two cities which are located in the southern region of Western Australia, and one of the important centers of gold mining, and not only gold mining but also copper mining. Remember this. It is situated to the northwest of Western Australia. Achha, next up, let us look at another area which is called as Pilbara. That is the another city, Pilbara. It is situated to the northwest of Western Australia and it is known for its iron ore reserves. So Kalgoorlie, Coolgardie, mainly for its gold mining as well as known for its copper reserves. Pilbara, it is known for its iron ore reserves. Lake Eyre, it is the deepest point of Australia. Very, very important. Already we had seen that Lake Eyre. It is a very large saltwater lake, and also remember it is the deepest point of Australia. Next, apart from that, you also should be aware about Adelaide. Adelaide is situated on the St. Vincent Gulf. Adelaide is situated on the St. Vincent Gulf. I think in the map you might be you might have come across this. So over here, if you can see, here it is Adelaide. So here you will find Adelaide is there, and over here we have some gulf, that is a part of sea has come into the land and it is surrounded by what? It is surrounded by landmass. So the sea is surrounded by land, so that is giving rise to this Adelaide. And here you have Spencer Gulf, and over here you have the St. Vincent Gulf. Okay. So Adelaide, it is surrounded by the St. Vincent Gulf. This is something that you should be aware of. Next, it is the capital and the chief port on the southern coast. Not the capital of Australia, for the it is a chief port. It is the important port of southern coast. Achha, what else do we have in Adelaide? We will have well-developed agricultural industries such as fruit canning, flour milling. Dairy industries are there, and woolen textiles, of course, are there, because I told you that Australia is known for its wool, for its wool export, for its wool production, and for sheep. So, well-developed agricultural industries such as fruit canning, flour milling, dairy industries, woolen textiles, all of these will be present. Similarly, if you look at Darwin, it is the capital and the chief port on the north coast, which exports timber, grains, and meat. So Darwin, earlier also we had seen, Darwin is present to the northern part of Australia, and Darwin, it is an important port for the north coast, and it exports timber, it exports grain, it exports meat as well. It is known for its iron ore reserves, and the city is also called as Australia's front door. So just in case if you are asked Australia's front door, then you should be able to answer it is Darwin, and it is known for its oil, for its ore reserves as well. Next up, we also have Alice Springs. It is situated in the southern part of the Northern Territory. It is connected by rail with Adelaide, and it has large reserves of oil and gas. That is, so far as Alice Springs is concerned. Apart from that, what are the other important areas that we have in Australia? As I told you earlier, the Murray-Darling area. Okay, Murray and Darling, these are very, very important rivers so far as Australia is concerned. And Murray-Darling Basin, this is the river basin. It is formed by the Australia's largest river system, that is Murray and its tributary Darling. So Murray-Darling Basin, it is formed by the largest or the longest river of Australia, that is Murray. And what is the tributary for Murray? It is Darling. So Murray and Darling together form the Murray-Darling Basin. Snowy River Scheme, Tully Falls and Shannon, these are major hydropower schemes or hydroelectric power projects which have been set up over here. So Snowy River Scheme, the Tully Falls as well as Shannon, these are the major hydel power schemes which have been set up over here. Okay, Murray-Darling Basin. Next, Sydney. Sydney is Australia's oldest and the largest city, and it is built on the low hills of the Pacific coast. It is the capital and the major port of New South Wales. So New South Wales province will be there, and it is the capital of New South Wales, also the important port for New South Wales. It is present on the low hills of the Pacific coast. is known for the it is a major center of iron and steel industry, paper and printing industry, chemical industry, also known for its lead and zinc and also silver mines. It's a major center for iron and steel, paper and printing, chemical industries. It is known for its lead and zinc and also for silver mines. Apart from that, we also get to see Newcastle is an important city over here. And Newcastle is situated to the south of Sydney on the coast of Pacific coast. So it is situated to the south of Sydney along the coast of Pacific. It is a seaport. It is an industrial town. It is a major center of iron and steel, non-ferrous metals and textile industries. Apart from that, let us also look at Melbourne. And before Melbourne, let us look at Brisbane. Brisbane is situated near the Ipswich coalfields. Ipswich coalfields is the capital and the chief harbour of Queensland. It is a major industrial city and a manufacturing centre for locomotives, machinery and processed food. So Brisbane, it is situated near the Ipswich coalfields. It is the capital and the chief harbour of Queensland. It is a major industrial city and it is a manufacturing center of locomotives, machinery and processed food. And then we come to Melbourne. Melbourne, it is a very important area. Melbourne, it is the capital of Victoria. Victoria province, you might be aware, it is situated right at the southern part. So Melbourne, it is the capital of Victoria. It is Australia's second largest city after Sydney. Sydney is the oldest one and it is also the largest city. After Sydney comes Melbourne. So it is the capital of Victoria. It is the country's second largest city and also former capital of Australia. Former capital of Australia means right now Canberra is the capital. And before this, we had Melbourne. It is the center of major industries. For example, you'll have lignite coal, hydropower. All of these are present over here. Plus, you will also have chemicals, shipbuilding industry, aircraft industry, engineering industry, railway equipments, motor vehicles. All of these are the major industries in Melbourne. Chemical industry, shipbuilding industry, aircraft, engineering, railway equipments and motor vehicles. These are the major industries so far as Melbourne is concerned. And lastly, we'll talk about Canberra. It is the nation's capital. It is situated to the south of Sydney. It is mainly an administrative city. Is the nation's capital. It is situated to the south of Sydney and it is mainly an administrative city, that is Canberra. Okay, so these are the important cities of Australia, and we'll close this session till here. We'll keep it till here. This was part one of Australia, New Zealand and the Pacific Islands. We have looked at the entire continent of Australia. Next up, we'll be looking at the important areas of Australia which have been in the news in the past 1 year, and we will analyze all these areas, not only from Australia but also from the surrounding islands like Tasmania, like New Zealand and all these islands we see in our next part. So I hope you have liked this video. This was part one of Australia, New Zealand and Pacific Islands, and please let us know in the comment section how you have liked this video. Also, please subscribe to Aptitus Academy for Civil Services YouTube channel for more such informative videos. Also, please share this video with the other aspirants who are your friends and preparing for UPSC, because it will be beneficial for them. And we'll be back again with another episode of Important Locations for Map-Based Questions. Till then, stay safe and take care. Thank you so much.